super kind of rambly. I'm trying to get better at describing synopses of books on my own without Goodreads and stuff. So I'm gonna try my best to explain these books to you. And I'm also gonna be filming my March wrap-up or my March reads directly after this, so the March reads will be up on time this month. Fingers crossed. Again, thank you for bearing with me. Again, so much has been going on in my personal life, it seems. One thing happens after another, and it just kind of sets me back. But yeah, thank you for bearing with me. And I also wanted to remind you guys to follow my Instagram and my Goodreads, which I've linked in my description box, because I post so much more on there because obviously I don't have to film for that. I'm constantly posting reviews on there. So yeah, if you want to keep up to date more, that's where you can find me. Anyway, let's get into my February reads. I'm gonna start off with my DNFs. I only had one DNF in February, which was good. And it was actually a physical book. And it was Confess by Colleen Hoover. I know so many people like this book, but I absolutely hated it with a fiery passion. I just could not get into I just. Let me explain the plot first. So basically, we're following. Let me check the character's name. So we're following Auburn. And she. Okay. For you guys. she agrees to go on this tour. And the guy, like the leader of the kind of group that wants to go on the tour, they like fall in love. It's really weird because like after like 2 days of knowing each other, apparently they're like head over heels. It's just, yeah, I gave this. Stars. It was like I flew through it. It was interesting, but the romance was so cringy and the dialogue was just so like unbelievable. And it kind of reminded me of when I would write romance fan fiction when I was like 12, and the characters would like fall in love within like 10 minutes of each other knowing each other, you know. And it was just kind of embarrassing, and there were so many plot points that didn't add up. So, for example, like problems that the characters would face earlier in the book, later in the book would suddenly not be a problem. And like, I don't know how to explain that without spoilers, but so for example, they'd encounter a creature and they'd have like might be really difficult to fight it off or whatever, and then later in the book they'd somehow just like make friends with the creature. I don't know how to explain it, but it was very messy. And yeah, it just wasn't great. The ending was also really random. So, it was okay. If you're interested, like if the premise sounds at all interesting to you, I would check it out, but I'm not gonna be, I'm not raving about it. The next book I read, I did really enjoy, and that was Untamed Shore by Silvia Moreno Garcia. I love Silvia Moreno Garcia. I think she has such a diverse backlist, and this book was actually, this is like a republished book. It was originally published, but they like republished it again. I can't remember why, but basically it's set in a small seaside town in Mexico, and it's set in the 1930s, I believe. It's like early 1900s, and we're following our main character. I can't remember her name. I'm gonna be honest, my character name, I forget them so easily. So I apologise for that, but our main character, she's 18. And she lives with her mother and is basically kind of relied on to bring the income in and to look after like her 6 or 7 younger siblings. And she wants more from life. She wants to travel to Mexico City to get into university. And she's just a really strong, independent main character. And basically, during the summers, she works as like, she kind of gives people tours of the local area for money. And this summer in particular, the book is set in, she gets offered a job for some American tourists who are staying for the summer in this big house that mostly sits unoccupied during the year. And she's basically there to dictate, take notes on this guy's book that he's writing. And upon meeting the family, so it's a woman and 2 men, and upon meeting the family, they're very rich, and she just kind of gets sucked into their world. And she kind of gets involved with one of the men, and yeah, it's just very much like you don't know who you can trust, and things just don't seem right. And then one of them dies, and she's kind of swept up into this kind of murder investigation, and she kind of has to decide how far she's willing to go for these people that she's just met, but that she's so become so entangled with. So it's almost like a historical get sucked into a very toxic relationship, if you can even call it a relationship. But she is very much got good for her vibes by the end of the book. And I just really enjoyed the setting of Mexico. I really enjoy learning about other countries and cultures, and there was definitely a lot of Mexican culture here. And I believe the author is Mexican, so love that. I love it when an author from that particular country writes a book about it, because they know the best, you know. So yeah, I would definitely recommend this book. I feel like it's for a certain type of person. If it's more of like an atmospheric book than plot heavy, if you know what I mean. It's very much, yeah, it's very much more like slow burn, tension building, than action or anything like that. So yeah. Then I read a YA horror novel called She Is a Haunting, and this is by, I'm gonna butcher this name, I just know I will. It is by Trang Than Tran, and she's a Vietnamese author. And again, this is a book set in Vietnam, which was so interesting to me. The food sounds incredible. Sorry, I'm just adjusting my foot. So anyway, this is a YA horror novel about a American Vietnamese girl and her sister. They are going to visit their, they live in America with their mother, and their estranged father, he got up and left and went back to Vietnam. They're going to stay with him for the summer, while he fixes up this old house into like a bed and breakfast. He's like poured all of his money into it, and he's trying to fix it up, and they've got a deal. The main character, and the main character's name is Jade, I remember her name. So she's Jade, and her father have kind of like a deal that he will give her the money that she needs for college, so she doesn't have to ask her mum for it, if she will stay the summer and help him with the website for his B&B, because they don't have a very good relationship, and he's just kind of trying to have a relationship with her. Anyway, we're gonna get straight into the action, and this house is very strange, weird. She starts having very strange dreams and sleep paralysis and seeing ghosts, and she starts seeing the ghost of this young woman. And yeah, I'm not gonna talk too much about the plot, because I feel like it's one of those where you kind of just go in blind, and the plot kind of slowly unfolds for you. This is also sapphic. There is, our main character is bisexual. Either she's either bisexual or she's lesbian. I can't remember, but there is like a kind of a romance subplot between her and another girl, which I really enjoyed. I didn't like Jade, the main character, at first, but you kind of see, you kind of understand why she is the way she is as the book goes on, and she also does grow as a character. I gave this book 4 stars. It's really, really good. A really good YA horror. If you're looking for a good YA horror, this is it. It was brilliant. Really creepy. Like, some of the scenes genuinely, like, creep me out. And yeah, this house was just extremely odd. It was a very unique haunted house story, in my opinion. I've read a lot of haunted house stories in my time, and yeah, this was incredibly unique in the way the haunting was manifested, if you know what I'm trying to say. But yeah, it was great. 4 stars. I would recommend that one. Next, I read, sorry, I've got my tablet here so I can check what order I read these books in, because obviously it's been a little bit. Then I read, I don't think actually, though I've got on this tablet, I don't think it's the order that I read the books in, but oh well, the next book on my list is The London Seance Society by Sarah Penner, and this was really, really good. studying under this famous clairvoyant because she wants to study the art of seance to try and basically connect with her sister, her deceased sister. Her sister was murdered and she wants to find out who killed her. And she thinks that the best way to find that out is to kind of contact her on the other side. So she is studying the art of seance underneath this famous clairvoyant. And then as they travel to London to investigate this other murder, they then think that perhaps the sister's murder and the president of the society's murders might be connected. And yeah, you're just kind of following the investigation, and there's so many twists and turns, and you really delve into the like underground kind of seance societies of Victorian England. And there's a really interesting author's note in the back talking where the author talks about how what her inspiration for the book and how kind of seances were really kind of one of the ways that women could gain power, because women were thought to be better at communicating with the dead because they had sensitive minds. And yeah, it was just a way for women to actually have some kind of power. And yeah, although, believe it or not, this book does have a very feminist undertone, although the men in this book are vile, absolutely vile. But it is very much a women kind of trying to take back power kind of situation, and the women in this book are very strong characters. And I gave it 4 stars, I really, really enjoyed it. Flew through it, could not put it down. And it's so atmospheric as well, you know, like Victorian London. It's described really well. I'm really, really interested in the Victorian era. I think it's such like a atmospheric and interesting time period. So yeah, I gave that 1 4 stars, and I would definitely recommend it if you like historical mysteries. It's a good one. Let's have a look. Oh, the next book that I read is one of my favourite of the year so far, and has become one of my favourite books of all time, and that is How to Sell a Haunted House by Grady Hendrix. I just adored this book. I gave it 4.5 stars rather than 5, which I'll explain why it wasn't a full 5 stars in a minute. But this book is like a horror book, it's a haunted house horror book. And basically we're following our main character as her parents die very suddenly, and her and her brother, who's a bit of a dick, honestly, they're left to sort through the house and get it sold. But this house does not want to be sold. And yeah, the weird stuff starts happening, and yeah, this whole thing unfolds. I'm not gonna say any more than that, because I will just say puppets. That's all I'm gonna say. But I 100% recommend this. The only reason I gave it 4.5 rather than 5 was because I thought some of the fight scenes were very repetitive, and some of the scenes in general were very repetitive, and it was a bit longer than I think it needed to be. But I really enjoyed the book overall, and I can't stop thinking about it. It was very creepy, very atmospheric. I mean, Grady Hendrix, I've only read My Best Friend's Exorcism by him, but I really enjoy his writing. He writes more of kind of like comedic horror, I would say, but it's not, it's still scary kind of thing. But yeah, I really enjoyed this one, and I really want to get myself a physical copy. I borrowed this one from the library. I want to get myself a physical copy because, yeah, I like to get physical copies of my favourites. But if you enjoy like a haunted house story with a twist, I would recommend this one. This, the way I wrote in my review, I would say this is literally like goosebumps. It gave me goosebumps vibes, like by R.L. Stine goosebumps books for grown-ups. That is how I would describe these books. This book. Okay, let's have a look. What's the next one? Okay, next. The next book was a bit of a dud. I read The Stranger in Our House by Sarah Denzel. This was an ARC that I received. And this is kind of like a thriller with like a horror undertone about a boy who goes missing. And then, like, you find it from the start of the book. It starts with him being found again, but he's found in a tree covered in mud with like scratches all over him. And then when they take him home, he starts acting really weird, and weird stuff starts happening. This is set in like a really small village in the UK, which I really enjoyed that setting. I enjoyed the kind of local legends that were woven through the book, and the legend is actually like it's based on a true legend in the north of England. But the writing style was so cheesy and just so unbelievable, and I just found myself a bit bored. I gave it 1.5 stars. It was told in like diary entries and stuff like that, but it wasn't written like a diary entry, if you know what I mean. So for example, like it'd be like, oh, somebody's just knocked on the door, so I have to stop writing now. Whereas like if you were actually writing in your diary, you'd just get up and open the door, you wouldn't write about it. And just, yeah, I really did not like the characters. I just, the whole thing went a bit crazy, and it was just not, it wasn't a good book. Would not recommend this one. Next, I read a romance ARC. If you don't know, ARC means Advanced Reader's Copy. But I read Just My Type by Fallon Ballard, and this was such a good book. One of my favourite romances of all time now. It was like a second chance romance, so basically we're following our main character, and she writes like a dating advice column. But she doesn't want to be doing that. She wants to write about like pop culture and books, and she has like a like her own little blog that she writes, but she very much keeps it private. She doesn't want to publicize it, and basically she's at the beginning of the book, she thinks her boyfriend's gonna propose to her, but he breaks up with her instead. And when she goes into work the next day, not the guy that she's proposed to, but her high school ex is there, and it turns out they're going to be basically working together, and kind of taking part in this competition for a column of their own in a really big online like newspaper. And it's kind of her chance for her to be able to write about what she wants rather than the dating stuff. And so the idea of the competition is they have to kind of, so basically our main character, she struggles with being single. She's basically not had any time alone since she was 14. She doesn't know how to be single, so her job is to write about being single. And then his job, her ex-boyfriend, his job is to write about being kind of settling down, because he's the opposite, he struggles to commit. He's got quite a reputation for kind of just having like casual hookups and stuff like that. And basically at the beginning of the book they write a list for each other of tasks that they have to complete and write about, and whoever gets the most votes at the end of each week, the readers vote each week on whose column they liked better, and then whoever the winner is, whoever gets the most votes total, will win the column in the big newspaper. And these characters, obviously, you kind of learn that something happened, because they're kind of you just kind of see these characters grow together, and maybe like things aren't kind of done between them after all, like maybe there's still some feelings there. I hope I explained that plot right. But just know it's a really good second chance enemies to lovers romance. The conflict I thought was well done, you know, with the romance, it's always a third act conflict. Like, I thought it was quite well done. Wasn't stupid. This did kind of rely on a miscommunication trope, but it was done well. I usually hate the miscommunication trope in romance books, but with this one it was done really, really well. And it was like realistic as well. And I genuinely felt the chemistry between these two characters. The banter was great between them. I really enjoyed the pop culture block side of things as well. Our main female character was extremely an interesting person. You know, she was, the characters in this book were developed really well. Side characters were really, really, really like cute, and just such, she had such a good friend group. She had a really cute friendship with her best friend. And it was just overall just like a really light-hearted, cute book. There was talk in this book discussion of complex relationships with parents, which I really enjoyed that. Which that bit is a little bit heavy, but I also liked the way it was resolved. And I thought it was handled really well. This book was just really, really, I flew through it. It was just such a cute, fun romance. So yeah, I gave that one 4.5 stars. And would really recommend that one to any romance reader, honestly. Like, it's a pretty solid one. The next book that I read was another ARC, but this one is available on Kindle Unlimited now. In the UK it is anyway. And it was A Dangerous Education by Megan Chance. And this is like a historical, it's kind of a historical thriller. Basically, our main character is set in the 1950s in America during the Cold War. And we're following our main character. We get flashbacks and present day. And in the present day, she's just got a new job at this boarding school for wayward ladies. So it's women that, as girls that basically don't fit society's expectations. So for example, they want to drink, they don't want to get married, things like that. And this school is basically designed to mold them into the perfect American wives and mothers, if you know what I mean. And our main character just disagrees with that. She's unmarried herself and in her 30s, which is quite an anomaly in that day and age. But we find out that so basically she gets this job and she grows close to these three girls who are kind of wild cards, really. They're a little bit strange. But we find out that one of those girls is actually the daughter that she gave up for, our main character gave up for adoption when she was a teenager, but she didn't want to go through with the adoption. It was kind of like a forced adoption kind of thing. So she basically grows closer and closer and gets sucked into these characters, these three girls. They're 17, I think. 17. Yeah, 17 years old. And they're very kind of sinister, and just, she's warned from the beginning to kind of watch them and be careful and not get too close to them because they are known to be a bit toxic. But she can't help herself because she knows that one of these girls is her long-lost daughter. So, she kind of gets sucked in, and then it just kind of devolves from there, gets worse and worse, worse and worse things that start happening, and she kind of starts to lose control of the girls and her relationship with them. I know that's quite vague. very dark academia vibes, and it's very much a vibe filled book. Like our main character, she wants to teach these girls like sex education and how to get like birth control and things like that, which is not allowed to be talked about in the school and things like that. So she gets in trouble for that and things like that, and it's just, yeah, it's like kind of like a thriller, just literary or historical literary fiction book. I gave it 5 stars. I was just hooked. I just had to know, like things just kept getting like more and more dramatic as the book went on, and I just had to know, you know, I wanted to know which one was her daughter. And you know, you're kind of constantly trying to work out, you're giving like little breadcrumbs as to, oh, that one might be it, might be the daughter, or it might be that one, and just seeing how far the main character will go to get close to these girls or to protect these girls is just, it's really interesting. But it's also, I would check trigger warnings for this because, yeah, it's quite dark as well. But yeah, I gave it 5 stars. Really, really enjoyed that one. Next, I read a fantasy book called Seven Faceless Saints by M.K. Lopp. This was fantastic. I gave it 4 stars. This is, I think, from what I can gather, it's based on like an Italian city, and these people basically are divided into, there's people who are kind of blessed by the saints. So there's there were seven saints, but basically I can't remember all the saints' names now, but one saint, Chaos, was basically scrubbed from history because his disciples, Chaos disciples, so people who have the magic of Chaos, they kind of got too out of control. So now it's just the 6 saints and their disciples who are blessed with the power of the saints. And then there are just people who are not blessed, and the people who are not blessed are not treated the best, and the disciples are kind of treated a lot better, and just are more well off. And basically we follow two main characters. We have our female main character, who again I cannot remember her name. Her father was murdered for deserting. There's like an ongoing war going on with another, I think it's another country or kingdom, and he was murdered for deserting, because basically disciples are immune from being drafted into this war and going on the front lines, but if you're not blessed by the saints, you are up for, you're sent to the front lines basically, and a lot of people are upset about that. Including this female main character. Her father was murdered by her childhood best friend's father, and her childhood best friend she hadn't seen since he was drafted. He went to war years ago, but now he's back, and he's now the commander of the security for, like, I can't remember what it's called. It's almost like the palace that houses all of the chosen, like, leaders of each saint. I don't know how well I'm explaining this, but basically the one of the saint, like one of the leaders, saint leaders, gets murdered, and there's kind of like an investigation going on, because our female main character, one of her friend's siblings was murdered as well, and she thinks that it might be connected. So she ends up teaming up with her childhood twists and turns and a enemies to lovers romance, and it's the start of the series, so I'm really excited to read the next book. But this is actually a debut, and I was shocked when I found out it was a debut because the writing's fantastic. And yeah, I just it was just a really interesting and twisty fantasy. I gave it 4 stars. Again, apologise for my terrible explanation of the plot. I'm terrible. Fantasies is like the worst for me. Like, I'm terrible at explaining a fantasy. Our next book is actually... Sorry about my throat. A physical book. And I finally read the book that everybody was raving about you last year. I'm Glad My Mum Died by Jeanette McCurdy. And this is a non-fiction book following Jeanette McCurdy. It's written by her, so like an autobiography memoir, talking about how she was kind of forced into acting as a child by her very narcissistic mother, and how she was basically kind of on a calorie-controlled diet from the age of, like, I think she was like 8 or 9. Her mum was very controlling, narcissistic, and, you know, she ended up developing eating disorders and addictions, and it's just kind of her memoir dealing with that. And yeah, it was very dark. Definitely look up trigger warnings before you look into this. It goes into a lot of detail about her trauma. There's a lot of problematic stuff in here. She talks a lot about things that she was a victim of when she was working for Nickelodeon on the iCarly show. And yeah, there's a lot of shocking stuff in here. But I gave it 5 stars because, you know, the things she went through and the way her writing in this, the way she tells her story is so raw and honest, and I'm just glad she's in a place now that she can talk about all of this and that she's doing what she wants to be doing. But yeah, this is one of those books that I would recommend it, but it's kind of one of those that you have to be in a certain place before you can read it. So, but yeah, I would say it's worth the hype. Scared when I see a book that gets loads of hype. I'm like, oh god, am I gonna hate it? But no, this was really good. And I think more people need to read things like this and see what traumas and people go through. Unfortunately, I identified with a lot of the things that she went through. Which I won't go into detail because that's not very relaxing, but for me this was a really kind of cathartic read. So, the final book that I read was another ARC, and this was a really, really interesting one, pretty funny and unique. It was the Drunkmaster's Guide to Homicide, How to Murder Your Employer by Rupert Holmes. And this is exactly what it says. It's basically like it's kind of written like almost like a textbook, but not, because that makes it sound really boring. It's not boring, it's very long, but it's like 400 something pages, but it's so interesting and funny. Basically, there's this academy, this very secret academy, where people attend and they basically learn how to delete people. Basically, they learn how to murder people. And in this one, we're following 3 characters who have all kind of had very bad experiences with their employers. We're following one guy who, at the beginning of the book, tries to murder his employer and fails miserably, and they basically save him and take him to the academy because they see potential in him. And then you're following one female character who works works. She works like at a hospital. And her boss is, I don't want to reveal too much about the motives because that's part of the, you know. But and then we also follow like a Hollywood actress. Who's also got some problematic stuff going on. But how the first half of the book, sorry, that was my throat. The first half of the book follows them at the academy. And you just see them go to all these classes, and there's like different kind of classes to go.